One senator who is against the latest charter change push is the president's sister, Aimee Marcos. She says economic provisions in the Constitution can be improved without amending the charter. Senator Marcos now joins us here on the program. Senator, good afternoon to you. Thanks for joining us today. Welcome to the program.
Yes, thank you very much.
I know it's been a long time. I think it was middle of last year since we've been trying to get you. We appreciate you coming to the phone to talk to us this afternoon. Senator, yesterday we had historian Manolo Quezon on the show, and he said for many years, the primary reason why efforts to amend the charter failed was because of the resistance coming from the Senate. But he also offered this observation. He said this time around, though, it seems like the Senate is now willing to come to the table and play. How much of this observation of his do you share, Senator Marcos?
I'm not certain in what context he spoke about it. But certainly the Senate objects to the proposed People's Initiative that's being undertaken these days. Well, I think the deadline was supposed to be last Sunday. And the Senate clearly objects to voting together because the intent was admitted and obvious that the 24 votes of the Senate would be lost in the 300 plus votes of the Congress.
Now, let's now move on. Yeah, go ahead, Senator. You wanted to add something?
Yes.
So, go ahead.
So the sense was that there was a desire to overcome the objections of the Senate by sheer number.
But now there is a directive coming from your brother. And in fact, in an earlier interview, you quoted the president against himself, saying this was not really the plan. He didn't find it important to change.
Sorry, I quoted him against himself.
Yes.
And lost.
When you said that in the beginning you were talking about this and plans to amend the charter, that wasn't in the plan because he felt at that time that it wasn't important. How does that now come into play with a recent directive to the Senate president to look into the economic provisions of the Constitution?
On the contrary, I think that what I said earlier is merely underlined by what has occurred, and that is that a charter change at this point may perhaps not be the most important issue in the minds of ordinary Filipinos, that we are far more concerned with the price of gasoline, the impending increases in that area, as well as the availability of cheap and quality rice. I think all these things are really uppermost in every family's household right now. And certainly, what I said earlier was that my brother, even before he was president, had discussed, as we are wont to do, the possibility of charter change. And he said very clearly that we hadn't recovered from the pandemic. There were still so many problems, and that really we should focus our attention on those problems that concern the average Filipino as opposed to the concerns of the Constitution. As a matter of fact, he said that would just divert our energies, our funds, and our personnel, and that would not be a good idea. The change now with the Resolution 6 at the Senate is merely a compromise, as I see it, that had to be hammered between the Speaker, who was insistent on his Project PI, versus the senators, who would have none of it. And so there appears to be an agreement to study once again, as exactly as the president said, through a subcommittee under the Committee of Constitutional Reform, the three provisions, the three economic provisions that have been provided, and thereafter submit, if necessary, to a CONASH, a constituent assembly, even though that term is not mentioned, and instead what is mentioned is a three-fourths vote in both houses voting separately this time.
But do you think you'll ever get that far, considering that there's no money, Senator?
Sorry?
Considering that there's no money, and if there is, it's a whole lot of money that you're going to spend on something that is
That's
not really
right.
important at this point. Go ahead.
Well, that's exactly my concern, that this isn't a burning issue. And when they provided, finally, because I kept badgering everyone, I said, you know, economic provisions can be amended, as we have amended them under the President Duterte. They can be amended, not through a constitutional convention, but instead much more cheaply, in accordance with law, as the Constitution itself states, in accordance with law, meaning that the lawmaking bodies can change them themselves. And we proceeded to do that in the past administration, and we went through a very, very controversial telecommunications area through the Public Services Act. Mm-hmm. We also have the Retail Trade Act, which now allows foreigners with small capital to invest in retail. And finally, the one that I sponsored, which was the Foreign Investment Act, which broadened the sectors in which foreign investment will be welcome. That being the case, I asked them repeatedly, I said, they asked enough. What are these economic provisions? And no list was provided. And when it finally was, I sort of giggled to myself because, firstly, it said the Public Utilities Act, which is already encompassed by the Public Services Act. As a matter of fact, it's pending in the Supreme Court because it's a law. Secondly, they said the Education Act. And I said, well, are you certain you want 100% ownership? We may no longer recognize or understand our children who become little foreigners. Mm. And in the meantime, we've been able to bend over backwards to allow international schools for foreigners, as well as specialist institutions like all the culinary and tourism academies that have flourished with foreigners teaching and owning, many of them. Mm. Thirdly, sabi nila, itong advertising raw, o di kaya media. Mm. I found it very laughable in the sense that advertising is such a meager portion of our industry, and certainly foreigners will be unable to write copy in Filipino. Is it so? And how many jobs can we really expect to generate through advertising? And if they indeed expect that to expand to all media, are we sure that we want 100% such that all Filipino broadcasters are wiped out by huge MNCs? I don't think so. So study is the most circumspect and prudent effort.
So despite all the points that you mentioned, Senator Marcos, why do you think that the motivation is so strong for those who want to tinker with the Constitution at this point in time?
Yes, that's why it became very suspect, and we started wondering, well, what they had in mind, and many wisecracked that, in fact, the intention was political and not economic. That's why an economic listing was never provided until the very end, and that, in fact, the sense was that there would be an insertion of the provision to convert from presidential to parliamentary so that just a handful or a few hundred would determine who would lead our country as opposed to the entire Filipino people.
Here's another thing that boggles the mind, Senator Marcos. You talked about all the points that you pointed out earlier, but then you also have the Maharlika Investment Fund, and then you have the Philippine Development Plan. The Philippine Development Plan makes no mention of tinkering with the Constitution for it to become a realization. You also have the promise of the Maharlika Investment Corporation that would bring in more jobs, bring in more investors. So these two, with these two, why is there a need now to even tinker with the Constitution?
Precisely. You're preaching to the choir, unfortunately. I'm in agreement with you, and I really don't think it's the right time or place to be discussing the Constitution. It's a little late in the day as well. It's so untimely. We are coming into the election by October this year. It'll be a second election cycle, and that'll be for the midterm. So many people are once again saying there won't be a 2025 election. Or the plebiscite will be included in the election as if our elections were so orderly, so neat, so organized that we can add yet another problem. This is the issue. As to the Philippine Investment Plan, yes, those have been approved as they have in the past. medium term, long term. And as to the Maharlika Fund, I have to be candid, I did not vote for its approval in the Senate, despite the fact that it was being pushed very enthusiastically by the administration. Unfortunately, I felt that, A, there is no extra money. There is no new revenue. We have no windfall from oil receipts or from other sources of funds. We are going to be taking the money from the land bank and other GFIs, and really, eventually, we'll have to be borrowing money. And that's not the way a sovereign or investment fund is started. Historically, Norway got from the North Sea oil. Historically, UAE and the rest derived from their oil receipts. In our case, we should perhaps have considered it with Malampaya. But today, we are in debt, and there really isn't any wealth to speak of. Secondly, I felt that the safeguards would really have to be put in place. We do not want a one MDB. Mm-hmm. We do not want to have all these dreadful experiences repeated after the armed forces, pension funds, and all these horrific things that have happened in the past with pension funds in the government. Mm-hmm. It's very, very important that safeguards be in place. And because of that, with apologies to my brother and the rest of the economic team, I said, I'm very sorry. I'm unable to vote for this.
All right. We're going to talk about your brother in a bit, but first let's talk about your cousin, the speaker.
You said all my relatives this morning, is it? this afternoon. Okay.
All right. So let's talk about that. First, you had a lot of allegations saying that there was communication messaging coming from the, or messages coming from the speaker's office. Yeah, talking about.
They weren't allegations. They're facts. I have them on my phone.
Exactly. That's what I wanted to talk to you about. What is your proof that in fact all these communication and messages were coming from the speaker's office? You also mentioned a name, Jethro Co. Yes. What's your proof for saying this, Senator?
Well, it's on my phone, and it's on the phones of many, many other lawmakers and city mayors. A lot of our mayors and friends have been asking me, is this the approval of the administration? What is this? I actually got a timeline long before Christmas. Hmm. Around December 15, I think this got underway. And actually, I will be pursuing the investigation regarding the vote buying that has been alleged and the promise of 20 million for every congressional district that could produce the 20,000 signatures by January 12. Hmm. So I will be pursuing that investigation. And I must say that the media has not been remiss in collating all the material. There are endless videotapes. There are many, many witnesses. There are photographs. There's all sorts of evidence that, in fact, these offers were made.
Do you think that these offers were made without the knowledge of the speaker, Senator?
It's unlikely because the numbers that were utilized were from the office of the speaker. In the beginning, I thought it could have just been some random text, but later on I realized that they were being followed up from the office of the speaker with staff and attorneys that are clearly employees there.
Which brings me now to an earlier interview that you had, Senator Marcos, and this is what you said. You said, para namang napipili natin ang kamag-anak natin. Okay naman si Martin dati. Hindi ko naman akalain na magkakaganito. Akala ko naman ay susunod lang siya. Hindi ko maintindihan kung saan galing to. Susunod sa alin, Senator?
Well, susunod sa kumpas ng presidente. Sinabi na nga ng presidente na wag na muna tutukan yung tsatsa at marami pa tayong problema. Eh, ba't hindi sumunod? Ngayon, sinabi na nga napaka-divisive ng Project PI nila. Abay, hindi pa rin sumusunod. Ang nangongolekta ngayon ng signature, yung mga public works contractors naman. Akala ko titigil na kasi divisive nga. So, this is becoming very problematic, and as I've said also repeatedly, lahat naman tayo may kamag-anak na kung minsan pasaway. Abay, pagtsagaan na lang ninyo ako, talagang hindi natin napipili ang kamag-anak.
Senator, which of the two is happening as we speak? Is it, you know, family issues causing the divisiveness, or is it politics getting in the way of family?
Well, I come from an intensely political family, and unfortunately, in my mind, trabaho lang, ano? Kapag hindi kayo nagkasundo sa isang issue, okay lang yon. Pero ito, nagiging malalim at alam ko na si Martin, si Speaker, may tampo sa akin pagkat sabi niya, kumakampi daw ako sa Duterte. And that was around October, I felt na may tampo nga dahil binabakbakan nga si Vice President Sara, tapos inupakupakan din si Presidente Duterte tungkol sa ICC. Abay, sabi ko, ba't naman ginaganyan? These are our allies, these are our friends, they have been true and loyal to us. There is no reason to pick a fight. This will be a golden age for Philippine politics if we can get it together and keep the solid north and the solid south. We have nothing better to think of except development, progress, and all the needs of our people. Why are we picking fights? So I think there was some resentment because of my very adamant defense of the Duterte portion of our unit team.
Which brings me to the next question, Senator Marcos. Where does your loyalty to family end, and where does your loyalty to the Dutertes begin?
Well, I don't think the Dutertes have put me in any position where I am conflicted. What is very clear to me is that for family duty, I'm always there, and I can always be counted on for help and support. However, the fact of the matter is I was voted into the Senate and into public office in the past by the Filipino people. I was not voted as a relative. Therefore, ang primary responsibility ko ay talaga sa mga bumoto sa akin, ang mamayang Pilipino. Laging mauuna ang bansa kaysa sa kamag-anak.
There was also this observation, Senator Marcos, that you're saying the Duterte line, you're towing the Duterte line. How much of where you stand now is of your own thinking, and how much of it is really about showing loyalty to the Dutertes?
I have no need to show loyalty to the Dutertes. I am simply a loyal person by nature and by family tradition. Many question the fact that there are Marcos loyalists after so many decades. And the truth is there are loyalists because we too are loyal to them. And that is the only reason they continue to persist and exist. The loyalty to the Dutertes is simply derived from the fact that they have been good friends and political allies. And more importantly, it should be noted that President Duterte, as his daughter, the vice president, really hewed the same independent and sovereign line that my father always espoused. It is my father's legacy to which I am loyal.
And finally, before we end this discussion, Senator Marcos, let's talk about you being a sister. I mean, you set out on this journey. You wanted your brother to succeed. And with the divergence that's happening right now, how does that make you feel?
Well, I'm distraught about the tension within the unity now, and I hope we are still able to patch things together. And I continue in my role as the self-appointed super ate ng Pangulo. At alam naman natin, kapag ate o sa Ilocano, kapag manang ka, pinagsasabihan mo ang mga kamag-anak at kapatid kapag hindi na tama ang gawa. Kahit pakinggan ka, kahit hindi ka pakinggan, dapat lamang sabihin mo ang totoo. Yun ang inaasahan sa nagmamahal na ate.
At this point, nakikinig ko ba, Senator?
Palagay ko nakikinig naman kasi wala naman masyadong inik yung kapatid ko, pero sa bandang huli, mukha naman magkapareho pa rin kami at magkapatid pa rin dahil nga kami ay tapat sa legasiya at pinamana ng aking ama.
Senator Amy Marcus there joining us this noon. Thanks again for taking our call. Really appreciate it.
Thank you very much, Carmina, and thank you to all those who are listening.
Thanks again. Take care.